to St. Paul Cathedral. A special welcome to all those who are visiting us today. Please turn off all cell phones and electronic devices as we prepare to celebrate Mass for the 27th Sunday in Ordinary Time. The participation aid for this Mass may be found on the Cathedral's website, ghocatholics.org. Since we are unable to take a collection, we encourage you to place your offerings in the designated containers at the Cathedral entrance and exit. Our celebrant is Fr Kris Stubna, assisted by Deacon Tom Berna. Please join in the entrance antiphon, "My Soul Aspires After Your Salvation."
Lord, have mercy. us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and the desires of those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend, my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded it, cleared it of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it he built a watchtower and hewed out a wine press. Then he looked for the crop of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done? Why, when I looked for the crop of grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? Now I will let you know what I mean to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing, break through its wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but see, bloodshed. For justice, but hark the outcry. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise about these things, keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you.
Just want to make a couple logistical updates for us before I begin my homily this morning. As you know, the Bishop, Bishop Zubik, released further guidance this week regarding the COVID restrictions in place for our churches in the diocese. For some places, the increasing capacity to 50% had a major impact, but not so much for us. At the Cathedral in St. Rosalia, we're pretty much at capacity. We can't unrope any more pews because we have to continue to safe distance, at least 6 feet. The wearing of masks is still required when you come to church. People have asked me, we really can't be here without wearing a mask. And we will, however, begin to distribute Holy Communion during the Mass. That will be one change. We're not allowed to use extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion yet to be as safe as we can, so only the priest or today, Deacon Tom and I will be able to do that. Everyone needs to come down the center aisle. Those on the two sides have to go to the back and come up the center aisle. We're trying to avoid unnecessary contact as you come and go. But we are going to try to resume the practice of distributing Holy Communion during the Mass instead of afterwards. But we would ask that you continue to put your kneeler down when you leave church. There's one way in that's not an exit door. You have to go out the exit door. Those are requirements of CDC. And if we don't follow them, we are being monitored. We may not be able to open. So everybody has to cooperate. You know, no one has a special reason for doing something differently. Your cooperation is really important. We have to clean and sanitize between every event. It's difficult. I want to thank publicly so many volunteers who have stayed after Mass and helped with that task. If you're able to help during the week on Sunday, for an extra 10 or 15 minutes, it can make a huge difference as we try to prepare the church for the next Mass. And finally, one more reminder that the bishop has asked out of charity and concern for the safety of the priest and one another, please try to receive Holy Communion in the hand. It may not be your tradition. It's not any less pious. We're simply asking you consider receiving in the hand during this time of pandemic because it's far safer and it helps us to keep everyone else safe. So just a reminder, out of charity, Christian charity, if you could consider doing that, those of you that typically don't, it would be a great gift and mean a great deal to all of us as we try to protect everyone. We hear today from the prophet Isaiah, and he speaks about the vineyard that ends up in the gospel parable as well, with the lips of Jesus. The image of the vineyard that really is the kingdom of God, entrusted to the people of Israel, as it is given to God's people throughout the ages. And he's entrusted to them the task of bringing to harvest, to bearing fruit in a powerful way, those grapes that God has already planted for the good of his people. But Isaiah reminds the Israelites they've squandered their duty out of a sense of greed, envy, selfishness. They've pulled themselves away from the task. It's not their vineyard. All that they have has come from God. And he expects upon his return that we will be able to give a good account for how we have tended to that vineyard. They want to take what isn't theirs and misuse what they've been given as a gift. And in the end, they lose everything. We know the story. They lost their land, their heritage, their temple. They were in exile for over 40 years. God doesn't forget them. But their misery is a result of their own disobedience, not God's fault. They lose everything, which is the danger for all of us in every age, if we fail to understand what the Lord is teaching us. Because the scriptures today remind us of several important realities that we need to keep close to our hearts every day as we seek to accomplish the will of God. First, it would seem quite simple to believe the fact that everything we have is a gift from God, but it isn't always easy to believe. So often we think that what we have is ours. We gained it from our own hard work, our own good luck, our own accomplishments, but God gave us all of those things in the first place. Everything we have is God's. And what we've been given in whatever measure, because each of us has been given different gifts, different talents for the good of God's kingdom, we must live every day with an immense sense of gratitude. You know, Meister Eckhart, one of the great mystics of the Middle Ages, said, if the only prayer we said every day is thank you, God, it would be enough for our salvation. How grateful are we? You know, when we pray, we're always telling God what to do, what we want him to accomplish, how angry we are with what he's caused in our lives. Do we ever pray simply out of thanksgiving and gratitude for all that God has blessed us with? That's the first point of today's readings. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel, and we are his cherished plants. We are God's chosen ones, his beloved. We've been given life by the hand of our Creator, and endowed with many good gifts, not the least of which is his grace, the gift of his Son, Jesus Christ, the gift of the church. But so often we fail to recognize that all we have has come from God, and we're called to be his servants. You know, today the church begins Respect Life Month. It's always kind of sad to think that we need a month to remind us of some very basic realities. God is the creator of life. And as the Catechism of the Catholic Church says, no one in any circumstance has the right to choose to end a life for any reason. That's why we have this month, to call us to our senses. We live in a nation where life is disregarded. How many abortions are committed every year because it's a freedom for someone to choose? It's not what the church teaches. The church says the preeminent priority for Catholics is to defend human life, especially the unborn, who have no voice of their own. But other lives are similarly dismissed. The elderly, the sick, the dying. Some people think it's even merciful to kill someone. It's never the case for Catholics. Suffering has a place in God's plan. We're joined to the cross of Jesus. God is the author of life. Every day, no matter what our circumstances might be, we're called to thank God for that gift, to protect it, to defend it, and to use our lives, all we've been given, to bring greater glory and praise to our Heavenly Father. Secondly, the scriptures teach us today that that gift we've been given without measure. We don't earn grace. We don't deserve it. God gives it to us freely out of his love. But secondly, that gift comes with great responsibility. That's the point of the two stories in the first reading in the Gospel. We have to work with our lives every day to increase the yield of God. Remember the talents that were given out, and one person buried it in the ground and just gave it back the way he was given it. That isn't good enough. We've been given tremendous opportunities by God. How well do we yield a harvest of goodness, of generosity, of kindness? Faith is not just a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's not what Catholics believe. Our faith unites us to our brothers and sisters. We're all part of God's family, and we have duties and responsibilities to each other. Faith requires us to be good stewards of all that we've received. You know, we live in a world where everyone focuses on what I need to be happy, what I need to be successful. We care very little for the people around us. We see it happening in our community. Hatred, bigotry, prejudice, violence, destruction of people's private property. Who would think we would see that in our own day? A disregard for the call that we all have to be brothers and sisters one to another in God's family. That's our call. Our call to build up, never to tear down. The responsibility for the needs of others, especially the poor, the vulnerable, those who do not have the same things that we have. How well do we care for them and share what we've been given by God in such abundance? And we know that thirdly, Jesus says, that's a work that will never be easy. It's hard work. It requires a great deal of sacrifice. But remember what Jesus says in the gospel, no greater love does a man have than laying down one's life for one's friends. It's what St. Paul tries to inspire us with today. That beautiful second reading. Whatever is true and noble, whatever is just and pure, whatever is honorable, whatever is lovely and gracious, think about those things. Foster those things in your hearts so that we can keep on doing what we have learned and seen in the person of Jesus Christ. The one who took upon his shoulders the sins of all of us and died on the cross so that we would be saved and given the opportunity for eternal life. The Catechism of the Catholic Church reminds us that we all share one call, one duty, one obligation in life, to be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. That's the Christian vocation. To become more and more holy so that we can reflect in our own lives the goodness, the pure love, the compassion and mercy that is God Himself. Anyone that wants to be great in the kingdom of God must be the least. The owner of the vineyard came back to see how well his tenants had harvested and what kind of fruit they had borne with what they had been given. And he was greatly disappointed, even angry, at how they had squandered all that possibility. It will be the same for us. God will expect an account of how well we've lived our lives. We can't bring anything with us into the kingdom of God. No possessions, no relationships. Nothing of this world can we bring with us. We will stand alone before God. But what we can give is an account of our service, our sacrifice, our good deeds, the things that we have done in life to build up the kingdom of God, to care for others, to defend and protect human life, to live in imitation of Jesus. So we pray for the grace today to bear fruit through our prayer, through the Eucharist, confession, through our good deeds, our love for one another. May we help to grow more deeply every day in the only thing that matters to God, become more perfect, more holy, more reflective of the love of God given to us in Jesus Christ. And so we make our profession of faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. So we place our needs today, the prayers of the church, into the loving hands of our Heavenly Father.
And our response today is, Lord, hear our prayer. For our Holy Father, together with our bishops and priests, that they may journey with the people of God with hearts of compassion, mercy, and understanding. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
President Trump and our First Lady, and that God may keep them safe and bring them healing and strength as they face the coronavirus diagnosis. And we pray for our country that God will guide us in peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to the great evil of abortion in our country, the respect for the sanctity and dignity of every human life will take root in the hearts of all people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who find life burdensome, especially the sick, that they will come to Jesus and find refreshment, strength, and hope in their struggles. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor and the unemployed among us, and for all those who need our help, that we may seek to share what we have with generous and compassionate hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the faithful departed, that they will come now to the fullness of life with all the angels and saints in God's kingdom. We remember Rachel Propogio, who was buried from St. Paul Cathedral this past week. And in a special way, at this Mass, we remember Max Anthony Weimert. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. We rejoice, O Lord, with grateful hearts for the many gifts you have bestowed upon each of us without measure. May we seek each day to bear great fruit for your kingdom as we seek to live in imitation of Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior forever and ever. Amen.
Please join in a verse of the Lord at your first Eucharist.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your divine commands, and through these sacred mysteries, which we celebrate with beautiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us. Through Christ, our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin Mary. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave to us eternal life. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Remember also our brothers and sisters who have asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. And with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, with Saint Paul, and all the saints, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume through Christ our Lord. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the divine power of God, cast into hell Satan and all of the evil spirits who roam throughout the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Just a reminder that today, October 4th, would have been the feast day of St. Francis of Assisi if it hadn't fallen on a Sunday. But we are blessing pets and animals this afternoon for our parish on the lawn of St. Paul Cathedral around 2 o'clock p.m. You're most welcome to join us for this annual blessing as we remember St. Francis. Beginning this Wednesday, we will be resuming our weekly novena to our Mother of Perpetual Help. We are not able to hold confessions in the church on Wednesday evening, but we will begin with Eucharistic exposition and adoration at 7 o'clock, and the novena prayers and benediction will take place at 7:30 every Wednesday evening. It's a beautiful prayer, particularly in this month of October that is dedicated to Our Lady. I invite you to consider joining us for this very special prayer that bears a great deal of fruit for all of us. Finally, a word of welcome to everyone. Good to see you and all of our visitors. A word of blessing to those who join us through our Facebook and television ministry or live streaming. You're always in our thoughts and prayers. May all of you have a very blessed and holy day. Please remember to put your kneelers down when you leave. It'll be a great, tremendous help to us. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go forth and glorify the Lord.